So this has been becoming a habit, I guess. Whenever I do a video, I get the owners to actually record me. So that's what happened for the last one. So I'm lucky that the owners actually play along with what I do. But this time we have 80 series, and a little bit about this 80 series. It actually was with us for very long. So not just the current owner, the previous owner used to bring it here as well. It started off life as 24 valve diesel 1HD FT. That's what they would call it, with the 4-speed gearbox. But chassis would be a HZ. So it's very common in Malaysia that people take the local spec model, which is the barn doors, and they convert it to the high spec import model that you normally see, that is highly sought after. This car went through a stage 3 restoration. So the only thing that we didn't do was paint and interior. That will be handled by the owner later on. So, but bottom end, so this had a full split cabin restoration. It's actually a resto mod, because we will talk about the engine that is in it later on. Starting from the bottom, what we are running for the suspension wise is we are running a hybrid. Initially, it started off life as an Old Man Emu full set off-road spec suspension, which is a 4-inch lift, a spring coil, and also absorbers. But because we had lack of adjustability with the absorbers, eventually the owner went with the Dobinson RR, which is, I think it makes world of a difference. And then for gearing, it's running 4.56 Yukon gears, front and rear ARB lockers. Front is actually a chrome only shaft RCV, which so far with the owner's wheeling method, he has not needed to actually really use it. Tire-wise, it's 35 inch on 16 inch rim. He was running 37s before, but I think with the gearing and now the current engine setup, what we have, 35 feels a lot nicer. And to be fair, where we go and play, 35 is already plentiful. So bar work-wise, front is pretty simple. It has an ARB bumper. Side steps and rear bumper was built in-house. So if the thing with why the side step, the owner wanted something different was the ARB ones are normally a bit narrow. So he wanted something that kicks out a bit more and then gives you just a better step. For the rear bumper, we actually even integrated it into the chassis. So it's not just mounted to the back, it actually has a link on to the side as well. Technically, although it's a 4-inch lift, the effective lift was about 3.5 inch, which is normal for most of the 4-inch kits, that even the ones from Pedders that we run, you ultimately will only get 3.5 inch. And with 3.5 inch, you can run 37s if you pick your offsets correctly. So without further ado, I think it's the time to talk about the real magic of this car. So I'm going to pop the hood and then we see from there. So as you can see, engine-wise, it's actually running a 2UZ straight out from 100 series. Funny enough, the donor vehicle is actually over there. So we bought a full vehicle to do the conversion. But if you look at the engine bay, it looks like it belongs. A lot of items that were not needed were removed. So front-wise, just to roughly run around, these dual batteries are connected in parallel. They are just permanently mounted together, mainly for winching and whatnot. And the gearbox that is behind this engine is actually a 5-speed gearbox. So the reason why we went with the petrol engine was initially the 1HD FT had a lot of it was smoking quite a bit, not the good kind of smoke, and the gearbox had issues. So the owner thought was either rebuild everything factory or go with something with a bit more power from factory as well. So there's no need to do much. And so from factory, this has a lot more than what the 1HD FT can produce. Obviously, it's not everyone's cup of tea. People will be like, oh, you got rid of a legendary engine and put in something like this. But to us, look, it can be registered. It's actually registered. So it's legal in Malaysia to have a conversion done like this, going from 4.2 to 4.7. Although a lot of people wouldn't register it, but the owners that we work with, they enjoy having a legal vehicle on the road. For the fuel tank as well came from the 100 series. So the pump is actually an LX570, the fuel pump that we're using on this. For cooler wise, like I always tell people, you know, the one thing that will kill a gearbox is the heat. So it has twin PWR coolers in the front. We run PWR on almost every one of our builds. But for radiator wise, it's still running an 80 series size, but the input and output has been configured to match a 100 series. So what we're trying to do is whatever spare parts that you can buy, if you just go off the shelf, you can just pick up 100 series parts and you're good to go. For wiring wise, we didn't take the entire harness and just chuck it in here like what most people do. So the entire harness was done from scratch. We integrated the 100 into the 80, and I think we did it quite seamlessly, because once we go into the interior, you'll be able to see it on the dashboard, and I think that's where we will head to now. So let's go there. You want to go the other side so you can see the meter? Any chance? Okay, if you can, just turn it on. So if you notice, the entire dashboard is actually an 80 series, but the 100 series meter has been grafted in, and everything works as it's supposed to be from factory. The shifter as well, so it's a five speed automatic gearbox. I'm personally a big fan of the autos. A lot of people aren't, but as a vehicle that you want to use as daily driving or even overlanding, I say go with an auto. The exhaust sounds sick, and I think we would have to turn it off so that people can hear me. And gauges wise, why it looked like there's so many was actually, it's just because it came from the diesel vehicle we had it on, hence why we just left it there. If you don't mind taking off the key. Yeah. The one thing I really like what the owner did was the current seat setup in this vehicle. We always had this issue. I would suggest to the clients to normally use back the original seats and do it back, because nothing beats a manufacturer spec. And a lot of the aftermarket ones they just didn't fit the car properly. But these seats are also, you don't mind if I, it's so new that I'm so scared to use it. So these are the SR seats, am I right? So they basically are brand new in Malaysia, brought in by Recaro Malaysia. And I think, and it's the rails and everything are fit for the 80 series. So I think this is one of the best seat upgrades that you can do in an 80 series. Absolutely comfortable. And the one thing that it did change was, I used to have a problem where the 80 series rail wouldn't go, the factory rail wouldn't go actually far back enough, where now this current rail gives you a lot more leg room. So I think it's an epic. It just changes how the vehicle feels, because you have a seat that holds you in. Besides that, I think there's modifications that you will not really require. So these are like from Roseanne. They are ridiculously pricey, but they just look epic, and they're direct fit for the Land Cruiser. Behind we have a simple drawer setup, but I'm not going to show it because it's raining now. So that's about it. Besides that, I would try to include whatever images that I did take before when we were restoring the vehicle. So it was a very complex process, because a lot of the conversions that we saw that had the 2UZ in 80 series, they were all left-hand drive. So they didn't have to deal with the steering box being on the right, which would come into contact with the alternator, which we managed to solve. But it was with a lot of thinking and custom fabrication of brackets and whatnot. But overall, I think right now how the vehicle feels, it drives and pulls like a 100 series, but it's capable like an 80 series, and it still has that classic look. In my opinion, it's one of the best conversions that you can do. That's all for now. I'll catch you guys on the next one.